Yeah. Hey. 9-on-1, Shelby Drive, look alive, look alive. Came up on this side, now they on the other side. Oh well, them dog, we gon' see how hard they ride. I get rested.
We're back. And I'm doing this thing. I'm doing it. Christian, I'm taking over. It's episode 18, Tigers in 20. Joining me, my co-host, I'm not the co-host this week, Christian Fowler, on the other side of the camera. Christian, what's up?
Brooks, I'm pretty sure I've been here for all 18 episodes, so I'll let you have the spotlight this week.
Come on, man, give me one episode.
You can have it this week. I'll give it to
you. Okay. All right, so this week, Houston, Memphis basketball, that was rough. So we're going to talk a little bit about that, but I think one of the biggest bright spots for Memphis basketball right now that we can talk about, probably the biggest bright spot from November all the way until next September that we'll be able to talk about, is the number one player in the country, and that's James Wiseman. We have some amazing content coming up on the site with James this week. We sat down with him today, you and Kenny did. So we're going to dig into that. We're going to talk some Memphis basketball the next couple games. And then I'm going to make a pretty bold statement about Memphis freshman guard Antwann Jones.
Once again, thank you for that beautiful introduction, Brooks. But to kick things off, we got to start with Sunday night's game between Memphis and Houston. I would personally say it was one of the tougher losses of the season. Memphis goes down 90-77. They got traction a couple times late in the first half, early in the second half. They started to make it a game, but Houston ultimately ran away with it. Once Armani Brooks got started, there was really no stopping him. He was hitting fall away J's. He was hitting threes. There was nothing Memphis' defense could do to stop him, and that's even with Kareem Brewton going off for a career-high 25 points. So it was a rough game, and it's really led Coach Hardaway and the players to talk about needing to be more physical, to step up their physicality, because like we've seen in some of their losses, they get out-rebounded, they turn the ball over. They end up just getting sloppy on the road, and Penny's really realizing that and starting to say that we need to work on our physicality, step that up, and allow 20 offensive rebounds in a game and expect to win. So he's starting to piece it together. I'm not going to be surprised if there's a lineup change. He still has a name to start in lineup. And when they've looked flat like they did against Houston, Penny's been notorious for flipping the lineup and switching some things there. So I'm not going to be surprised if that happens. But, Brooks, what did you think about that game on Sunday night?
Well, two of the words you used in that description was sloppy and defense. And to me, that's what I took away. You know, I think, yes, Memphis got sloppy with the turnovers. They got sloppy offensively. They took some bad shots. But honestly, to me, it all boiled down to when you're giving shots, open shots to Brooks, when you're giving open shots to a Houston team that already shoots the ball well and scores at a high clip and doesn't give up a ton of points. I mean, for Memphis to even get to 77, that was quite a feat. So I think their biggest fault in that game was they got really sloppy and undisciplined on defense. You saw a lot of scrambling on defense, a lot of really just a ton of real sloppy closeouts trying to get to shooters, over pursuit, trying to jump passing lanes and missing passes and. So to me, that's really where it all broke down for Memphis. Every time they made a run and tried to get into it, they actually had a shot to get it down below half a dozen late in the game. You know, so for me to see anyone say that Memphis was never in that game, I think that's dishonest. I think Memphis was in that game. They just could never get over the hump because they were not good enough. They were not disciplined enough on defense. I think the other part is that they were sloppy on the boards. They just were not disciplined in sealing their men, getting into their space and really closing out their rebounding area and trying to grab rebounds. Houston had a ton of second chance points, a ton of points off of turnovers. And so you put all that together and it was just a recipe for a double digit loss for Memphis on the road.
One more thing on that is just the weaknesses of this team are becoming really obvious. You can tell on the offensive end that they've figured it out for the most part. They tend to get a little sloppy and turn the ball over every once in a while. But as far as scoring, they're having no problem doing that. Like you mentioned, Houston is one of the top defenses in the country. They only allow 58 points a game, and Memphis hung 77 with, like I said earlier, Kareem Brewton get 25. So it's not the offensive end of the floor. They really don't have many issues down there. It's strictly the defensive end of the floor and getting rebounds. And that's two things that I feel like over the next few games we'll see them work hard to fix and to adjust. And if they can do that, like you said, they were in that game with Houston. They played with Houston early in the second half when Kevin Davenport was on a tear. It was a four-point game. So if over the next four or five games they can figure those things out, they have to do it quickly. It has to be with a sense of urgency. But we know what this team is now for the most part, I believe.
Yeah, Christian, so you hit on exactly the next thing I want to talk about, and that's the next stretch of games for Memphis. After the Houston loss, Penny Hardaway essentially said that loss for them was concerning because in all of their five big games, they're 0-5 this season, and they lost all of them for the same reason. A lot of people glazed over that quote, but this week you wrote about that and dissected what you felt like Penny Hardaway was talking about when he said that. So when you read or when you hear that quote and you write about it, and you dissect that, what does Memphis have to do in their matchup against SMU, against Central Florida, against Temple? Temple, who this week, after Memphis went into Houston and lost to Houston, Temple goes on, Houston goes on the road to Temple and loses. So Temple is establishing itself as one of the top dogs in the conference. UCF is up there. SMU is up there. So three of Memphis's next five games are against the top, some of the top contenders in the conference. So for you, looking at these games, what does Memphis have to do to contend? What do they have to do to correct that one reason that Penny is talking about, that they lost those five games?
I think when you really break down what he said and dissect that quote, like you were saying, it's really twofold. It's some of the things I mentioned earlier with the rebounds and the defensive end of the floor, the technicalities of the game, the fundamentals of the game. It's all those things. And then it's also the freshmen. As unfair as it may be to judge the way the freshmen have played so far early in their career, Penny is heavily relying on those guys. And those players knew that from the beginning. They knew that they were going to be heavily relied on. They knew they were going to be involved in the rotation. And for the most part this season, they've played well. But they really can't afford to have games like they did on Sunday night against Houston. When you look at the box score of that game, Antwann Jones, Tyler Harris, Alex Lomax, your three freshmen that play, 20-plus minutes a game, combined for 7 points and 7 turnovers. And that can't happen. 7 turnovers between the three of those, that can be excusable. But 7 points between the three of those, absolutely not. It's not good at all. And we know that Alex Lomax isn't the greatest of scorers. That's okay. Tyler Harris has been in a bit of a slump over the past 5 or 6 games. His shot has not been falling like it was early in the season. It really was Antwann Jones, for the most part, especially since entering the starting lineup. It was really his first bad game of the season. But with the expectations that are put on him and with him being moved into the starting lineup, he can't have duds. I mean, bad games are understandable.
He can't have a goose egg. He had a goose egg.
Yeah, you cannot have that. Like I said,
in his prior five games, he was averaging 12 points and 4 assists a game. A handful of rebounds. So he was doing a lot for Memphis. And to go into one of your biggest conference games of the year and to lay a goose egg after 5 straight games of having big-time performances, Penny's definitely got to be concerned about, can his freshmen step up in the big moments? I mean,
Absolutely.
Do you think they can? Can they go into these games against UCF, SMU, and Temple and actually, perform at a high level?
Yeah, so if you break down these next 5 games, like we've said multiple times, you've got East Carolina's the first of the 5-game stretch on Thursday night. Then you've got Tulane Sunday night. And then it's SMU, Temple, and UCF. And I've said this multiple times earlier in the week that the first two games, the ECU game and the Tulane game, even with ECU knocking off Cincinnati, those, especially with it being in the FedEx Forum, those are two very winnable games.
They're very
Tulane's at the bottom of the conference. They're last in the conference. They should be able to go into New Orleans and take care of business. And then those next 3 games, the 3 of those 5 games are massive. I mean, those are really the rest of your season, if you have any hope now, and this is a small percent now, but if you have any hope of making it to the tournament or going deep into the American tournament, these three games are really going to define the season for Memphis.
Stop, Christian. Stop. Let's just end the debate here. And I'm sorry if this offends people, if it hurts the feelings of any staff members who happen to watch this. Memphis is not making it to the NCAA tournament. This is recorded. You can come back and hold this over my head if it happens. But Memphis is not making the tournament as an at-large team. Period. End of story. Everything for Memphis is all about building to that AAC tournament. All about it. So, yes, these next three games are important, not because it puts them in the conversation for any kind of at-large bid, not even remotely a chance. It puts them in a conversation of being able to compete with the top teams in the American and gives them something to play for when they get into that conference tournament. That's it. That's it. Are you speechless? Am I being way too aggressive right now?
No, I don't think you're. That's what I was saying. A very small chance. Obviously, you
small
disagree.
Small chance as in zero.
It's close. It's close to zero.
It is zero. If there's a way to assign a percentage chance less than zero, Memphis's chances would be in the negative from my perspective.
Okay,
and that's
all right.
That's not being negative. It is what it is. It's a numerics thing. It's all about the rest of their schedule. Any chance of getting high quality wins that put them in that top 50 of the new rating system, they're gone. Memphis cannot, they could win out, and they're not going to be in that top 50 conversation, which is where they'll have to be an at-large team.
Well, I will add one thing to that, and it builds off of what you're saying with them not being a tournament team. No one expected them to be a tournament team this year.
For sure. And I'm not crucifying them because of that. I'm just saying the fact of the matter is they're not a tournament team right now. I'm not saying that they can't win the tournament and get a bid. And that's okay. The roster is what it is. Like you said, the deficiencies with this team are becoming very evident. And I think they were pretty obvious going into the season. Memphis was going to have trouble rebounding the ball because they have two guards that are under 6 foot that play a lot. They have one of their best big men sitting the bench ineligible this year. So I think that it's pretty obvious that they were going to have deficiencies going into the season, and they are what they are. Now it's just about, like, can their freshmen continue to improve, put them in the conversation of just competing? You know, instead of losing by 13, are you in it till the final 3 minutes of a game with a chance to win it?
So
that's what I want to see.
Basically what we're saying, Brooks, and no more beating around the bush about it, but just to say it, when you break it down and look at it and everything that you've said over the past couple minutes, it's all building towards what everyone is already ready for, which is next season. And it's not fun to say that 15, 16 games to the season, but when you look at it, all these freshmen are getting playing time. They're about to hit the meat of their conference schedule, or the hardest stretch of their conference schedule. So it's building momentum. It's winning those games that people said you aren't gonna win or have no shot to win. And then you build that until the conference tournament. If you finish second or third in the conference tournament and you go out on a high note, say they went to the conference championship and lost to a team like Houston, okay, that's perfectly
fine. You build
on
it for next year.
Yeah, no one's gonna be upset about that because you have a ton of momentum going into what is supposed to be Penny's first big season, with which will basically be his full team. It'll be the guys he recruited.
Christian, you're dead on. This year with Penny Hardaway, this is his moment, similar to Justin Fuente's moment when he benched Jacob Carib and he decided to play Paxton Lynch as a freshman. He was building for the future. Paxton ended up being the future of the Memphis football program, the face of the Memphis football program. And that was a very controversial decision at the time. Memphis didn't win a lot of games that year. but it helped prepare Paxton for the games that mattered a year later. So, I see Alex Lomax, Tyler Harris, Antwann Jones, these freshmen really, really being prepared for the games that matter, not this year, but next.
So, Brooks, coming off of that topic about Antwann Jones and the freshmen, you teased a little something at the beginning about Antwann Jones and a statement you had on him. Is this where you want to go ahead and throw that out there?
Yeah, I might as well. I mean, this isn't exactly the week that I want to do this, since Antwann laid a goose egg and didn't have a great game at Houston on Sunday. But, man, just stepping back and looking at the big picture, yes, Antwann has been completely inconsistent. He's been in and out of the lineup. He's had some games where he played barely any minutes. But since Antwann, in Penny's own words, has gotten his head right, they've been able to play him more, shift him to the starting lineup. Honestly, when I look at this, and this is going to be controversial, and I would love for people to discuss this. And I'm totally wrong. Okay with being wrong. I tell people all the time, I'm okay with being wrong. You can ask my wife, I'm wrong all the time. but Antwann Jones is Memphis's best freshman since Tyreke Evans. That's my statement. And here's why I'll say that. Antwann Jones, his worst enemy, in Penny Hardaway's own words, is himself. He is as good as he lets himself be. And Antwann has struggled to really play meaningful minutes up until the last six or seven games, and that's really because of attitude, behavior, really just trying to be a good teammate and really fit within the system. Now that he's doing it, over that five-game stretch before Houston, he was averaging 12 points, 4 assists, 5 rebounds. Will Barton, who was obviously after Tyreke Evans, averaged 12.3 points and 4.9 rebounds, 2 assists a game as a freshman in 31 minutes. Antwann Jones is doing that in like two-thirds of the minutes. And so I know that overall, big picture, his season hasn't reflected the statement that I'm making, but in terms of talent, in terms of the potential of what Antwann Jones can do and bring for Memphis, I'm willing to put the Brooks Hansen stamp on that statement. Antwann Jones is the best freshman for Memphis since Tyreke Evans.
I actually do want to piggyback on that for a second because I've been high on Antwann. Really, you were who turned me on to him, and you were very high on him before he even played a game, and really as soon as he committed to Memphis. So I did my homework on him and was impressed, and then the first time I saw him in person, I just saw something special. I was sitting on the sideline, and seeing the way he sees the floor is just – it doesn't happen very often. So I've been high on Antwann for a while now, and I think we talked about this earlier in the week or a couple weeks ago. And I made a little bit of a bold statement of my own and said that, Keevan Davenport, Jeremiah Martin, Kareem Bruton, all these guys are great players. But right now, Antwann Jones is the best player, and kind of the same thing you said, from talent perspective, he's the best player on the team. I don't even know if that's that crazy to say. Keevan Davenport's had some great games. He can take over games, but consistent level talent-wise, what he brings to the table and what he could be, Antwann Jones is the best player on the team, in my opinion, and I really don't think it's that close.
Here's the thing. Ability, talent, what he brings to the floor from a versatility perspective, defense, offense, passing, floor general, everything for Antwann Jones is about putting it together. Once he puts it all together, it's over. And here's the scary part, is if Memphis can build that confidence and show him the formula for his success over stretches of games like the last five of the last six, Antwann Jones is suddenly a sleeper for being one of the best players on the team next year. And that's crazy thinking about the class that Memphis has already committed and more on the way in the late signing period. So, Antwann has a chance to make a real meaningful impact for this Memphis team. And my hope is that I get to sit back and watch it all play out in a positive way. For the rest of the show, all we're talking about is James Wiseman, James Wiseman, James Wiseman. Christian and Kenny had a chance to head down to East Gym and catch up with James Wiseman, number one player in the country, one of Memphis's 2019 signees. So Christian, what's one thing you took away from your time with James Wiseman today, and what do you have coming for our Go Tigers 247 subscribers?
Well, Brooks, just to allow people to see how big me and Kenny sitting down with James and doing that interview was on Wednesday, there's two things, really. The first thing is every time we have something big on Tigers in 20 or we tease something big on Tigers in 20, we never name drop, we never say who it's about, and we definitely never tell what it is. And we just did all three of those right there. So that's the first thing to let you know how big it is. Second thing is James Wiseman's been interviewed countless times during his recruitment. I mean, he's been the number one player in the country for over a year now, I believe, and he's been highly recruited since his freshman and sophomore season. So he's sat down with people multiple times and heard just about every question in the book. Not every question in the book. They've actually been probably the same few questions every time.
On repeat.
On repeat. Before he was committed to Memphis, I'm sure he got these questions like, who are your top five? Why are they your top five? And getting questions about
the team. Does anyone outside of Memphis and Kentucky have a chance?
Yeah, yeah. And then asking about the head coaches, asking about Calipari and guys like that. And then asking, you know, how did you go throughout the process? How was the process, this and that? And then after he committed to Memphis, it was, why did you commit to Memphis? How did your relationship with Penny Hardaway affect that? And then who are you recruiting now to come to Memphis? It's basically been those questions throughout, you know, every time he's been interviewed. So we got a chance to sit down with him at length and get a little bit more description on James. But my biggest takeaway from the interview would be when we asked him about his biggest moment, his favorite moment from his five official visits and what really stuck out to him. And this is what he had to say.
I'll say when I went to the Memphis Madness, they showed me on the Jumbotron for like 5 seconds. But it was kind of crazy though. Like, everybody went crazy, the crowd went crazy, so that was like a surreal moment as well.
So you can really hear it in that clip, James's love for Memphis and one of his favorite moments, or his favorite moment from his recruitment process. So Brooks, with that being his favorite moment, what do you take away from that?
Well, I mean, for me, you look at that and you now see that with at least two of Memphis's recruitments, the commitments, in DJ Jeffries and with James Wiseman, both of them have now publicly talked about moments that really, really cemented things for them. So for James Wiseman, he's openly talking about that is his favorite moment from all five official visits. And it really, really puts it into perspective that that moment for James really brought it all home. So you look at DJ Jeffries and he's talked about that last in-home visit with Penny Hardaway and staff, just it sealed the deal. So you see now that these guys are painting a picture that for a lot of recruits that there's a moment where it all kind of becomes clear. Everything else fades away and it becomes clear in that very moment. Now they may not realize it in that exact moment, hindsight's 20/20, but every recruit, or at least a good majority of them, have a moment where it becomes obvious where they need to go. So I would say one of my big takeaways is now as we head into the spring signing period and we watch and monitor recruitments like Trendon Watford, Matthew Hurt, Precious Achiuwa, Damian Baugh, Lester Quinones, who else? Who am I missing? And even guys in the 2020 class that could reclassify, Jalen Green, RJ Hampton, Kyrie Walker. You've got half a dozen guys that you now need to keep an eye on and say, is this dude having his moment right now? Is Kyrie Walker having his moment of clarity where it all comes home for him? Is Trendon Watford was sitting at Alabama's court in their arena watching them beat Kentucky this weekend? Or was that his moment? Or was watching Clemson beat the shit out of Alabama this week, his moment of clarity where it's like, hey, you know what? I really want to leave the state of Alabama because look at Clemson's number one receiver option in Brooks. He's from Phoenix City, Alabama. He left and went to Clemson. He's doing amazing things. He looks like a pro as a freshman. I can leave too. Is that a moment for him? You just never know. I find it really interesting that you just never know what might be that moment. So I know that's probably not the takeaway you wanted me to have, but I think that's an interesting one at least.
Well, Brooks, now that we've talked about James Wiseman and this moment, I would love to talk about his game and the way he plays. But first off, I've got to make a correction because I appreciate the fact that you tried to bring football in the national championship game. But Clemson doesn't have a receiver named Brooks, man. His name is Justin Ross. He might be from Phoenix City, Alabama. His name's Justin Ross. Anyway, thank you, Brooks.
It's got an O in it and an R. I was, and an S. I was close. I'm horrible with names. I think through 18 episodes of Tigers and 20, we're learning. I'm going to mess up names, and I'm going to mess up records. So let's just forgive
me on that. It was a beautiful connection. It was great, but name was a little off.
I just went with it.
Yeah, I can't let you slide on that one. But anyway, to talk about James Wiseman a little bit now, I've gotten the chance to watch him on multiple occasions. He is everything he's cracked up to be, just to put it simply. I mean, there's a reason he's the number one player in the country. Every facet of his game is really polished, which is rare for a high school player, and sometimes even five-star guys really aren't that polished. James is so smooth, moving the ball up and down the court, which is absolutely unfair at nearly 7'2" to be able to run the floor like a point guard. God was good to him. God was good to him. And past that, I feel like he's a pretty underrated shooter, especially down on the baseline, off the block, pulling up and shooting. Nobody's going to touch that. I mean, if you look at guys like Kevin Durant that can pull up like that are near 7-footers, James Wiseman easily gets that separation on his shot because nobody's hanging with that. He can step outside, he can hit the three, and then I don't even think we have to talk about him down low because he's a force. When we were talking to him on Wednesday, I asked him about their game against White Station. Just, what'd you have last night? He's like, I think 32-17. And that's pretty much what he gets every night, and it seems remotely easy. I mean, he's an incredible player. He can do everything on the floor. And when you see these top-ranked centers, even nowadays, even that the position is more athletic now, they can't do these things as a senior in high school, not even in college. It's usually not until they get to college when their outside game gets polished up and they're able to develop as outside shooters. James is already very developed, and to watch him play, he's a monster down low, like I was saying. This team is missing a rim protector badly right now. They need it. Enforcements are on the way because James Wiseman at the rim. I mean, I've seen guys shoot mid-range jumpers and they get blocked by James, and it's definitely not goaltending without a question. So the things that he does he has a very unique skill set. Not many guys possess what he possesses. So he's extremely impressive all over the floor.
Well, for me, whenever I watch James Wiseman, one of the things that sticks out for me is you mentioned it. It's his ability to run the floor. There's a guy here in Birmingham. He's a class of 2020 point guard. His name's C.J. Burns, and he will be a Division I guy, not because he's an extremely talented guy. He is not a top 150 four-star point guard, but he will play Division I ball because he plays on a team with another guy who's a four-star level guy. College coaches will offer him because of one skill and one skill alone, and that's his ability to communicate. James Wiseman will make millions of dollars in the NBA because of how well he runs the floor, and for that skill alone. Now, I'm not saying that's the only thing he does. He does everything you talked about and more, but it's just that one thing that makes him special. He runs rim to rim faster than a lot of guards do. And so that skill, you look at a team like Army, they went into Duke and they hung in with Duke, not because they have the talent to hang in with Duke, and it got a little bit out of control at the end, but they hung in there because every time they had the chance to push the ball, they ran. They pushed the ball without ever having to put the ball on the floor. They simply shot on an outlet, pushed the ball ahead, scored at the rim in transition. And James Wiseman now, next year, gives Penny Hardaway an extremely good option in transition. When you talk about how he's like, fire it, you know, get that outlet pass and go. He wants his bigs to be able to rebound the ball and create that transition. James Wiseman does that, period. So that's what I look at every time I see that. I'm like, that's Penny's dude for a reason. He's going to create that option for Penny Hardaway's offense. All right, speaking of correcting myself, I'm moving on from James Wiseman. And to wrap up the episode, I want to make something clear. I did not forget about Dedrick Lawson when I'm talking about Antwann Jones. I'm sitting here, and in the background, we're recording on Wednesday night, in the background, on my 65-inch TV, I'm sitting here watching Dedrick Lawson.
That was so bougie, dude. Who cares?
On my big TV that I see very clearly right in front of my face, Dedrick Lawson in Kansas matched up against TCU. He's right in front of my face. I don't care about Dedrick Lawson. Dedrick Lawson is gone. Memphis fans have pretty much written him off. The Lawsons, let them do what they do, but I'm not including them in the discussion as it relates to Memphis stuff. So it's irrelevant. Dedrick, I love you, man. You're doing great things. You're going to be a pro. You're going to make a lot of money playing ball, but you're not in this discussion. It's Antwann Jones, Austin Nichols, Joe Jackson, Chris Crawford, Tarik Black, Will Barton. It's those guys versus Antwann. Somebody fill in the gaps for me. Can I be right? I think I am. But you tell me in the comments. I want to know, like, just how wrong I am. So, Christian, I guess I don't have any kind of commentary for today, but I do want to tell you I finished off a bottle of Michter's American Whiskey this episode. I'm not drunk. This was just almost gone. So if anybody wants to buy me a present, this is one of my favorite bottles. So I need another one. But other than that, I got nothing. You?
Why'd you tell me about the whiskey? Like I care. But anyway.
Because you need, I'm trying to get you to buy me a bottle of whiskey.
Anyway. No, just thank you guys for watching. Obviously, stick around for the James Wiseman content. That should be coming out shortly. So stay tuned to GoTigers247.com. We got a lot of good stuff coming out with him. You don't want to miss that. Really the first sit-down interview with the number one player in the 2019 class and Memphis commit. Definitely got some good stuff in there. A lot of things to be excited about. Other than that, I think we're good. Thank you guys for sticking around. 18 episodes deep now. And peace out, Brooks. That's it.
That's a wrap. 901 Shelby Drive. Look alive, look alive. Came up on this side. Now they on the other side. Oh, well, them dog. We gon' see how hard they ride.